Welcome, everyone. Thank you so much for being here tonight. You know, we're so often encouraged to think that the global economy is some sort of force of nature that we have no control over, and you can't possibly understand unless you're an economist. And, you know, certainly can't have any influence over. And it's so nice to be in a room full of people that can see that that's a manufactured myth. So my name is Elizabeth Swagger, and I'm the assistant director with Oregon Fair Trade Campaign. We're a statewide coalition of labor, environmental, and human rights organizations working together to fight corporate globalization through free trade agreements like NAFTA. At the same time, we work to promote a positive vision of international trade. So that's trade that includes strong, enforceable labor standards and environmental protections. So I'm going to take about 15 to 20 minutes to just talk to you about free trade agreements and their impact here in Oregon. And then I'm going to give you an overview of a trade deal currently being negotiated called the Trans-Pacific Free Trade Agreement. In terms of its size and scope, it really puts many of the past trade deals to shame. And after that, we're going to hear from our panelists who are going to be speaking about free trade deals and their impact on jobs and their impact on the environment. We'll talk about what's at stake with this new multilateral free trade agreement, and we'll talk about the importance of cross-issue solidarity. I'm going to start off with just giving you a little anecdote to help us remember why trade policy is so important. So how many of you have currently heard stories about Foxconn in the news, if you can raise your hands? Oh, wow, quite a few. All right, so maybe you heard these stories on This American Life or The Daily Show. I think there was also an article in the New York Times last month. Foxconn does make the news from time to time, but not as much as you would think because they are such a, you know, they're such a big corporation and have such a massive role in our global economy, you'd think they'd be on the news more regularly. Foxconn is said to make about 40% of the world's consumer electronics. It's pretty massive, and they have more employees in the global workforce than Apple, Microsoft, Dell, Intel, HP, and Sony combined. So, you know, they're a massive corporation. The main thing that they're known for nowadays are iPhones, but they make a wide variety of electronics. The majority of their workforce is in China. So you're supposed to be 18 years old in order to get a job there. And from what I've heard, the majority of workers are, you know, in their late teens or early 20s. However, it has been reported that there's 15, 16-year-olds who fake their papers and get a job there, and there has been 12-year-olds known to be working there. Standard shift is about 12 hours a day, 6 days a week, but 16-hour days are reportedly common, and during rush periods, people have been known to work 12-hour shifts, three 12-hour shifts back-to-back. So that's a 36-hour shift. There are ultra-modern facilities, high-tech, so you would think that everything's being done by machines. But no, it's not. Everything that can be done by hand is done by hand because it's so much cheaper. So instead of having a machine that's placing a tiny microchip on a circuit board, you have humans doing that thousands of times a day, and many of them become crippled within a couple years. Another extremely hazardous problem for a lot of workers is the toxic chemicals. So in electronics, there's a lot of toxic chemicals used. If you ever get a chance to watch the documentary Digital Handicrafts, it talks about a lot of this. And there's one woman who had been working at Foxconn for 8 years, and her skin started to turn green because she was so ill with the poisoning. Because she was a migrant worker, she didn't have a permit to stay in the city and to get treatment, so she was forced to move back to her village, jobless, poor, and now seriously ill. Workers make about 36 cents an hour. They live in dormitories that are about 8 to 12 bunkers jammed into a room. In 2010, Foxconn made the news because a lot of these workers kept away from their families, working in these grueling conditions, were opening up their window or going up to the top floor and jumping off of the roof to take their lives. This was a wave of suicides that, you know, this was the first time that Foxconn and Apple and their connections started to make the U.S. media. As a response to the negative PR, Foxconn decided they'd take some corrective measures. So what they did is they installed nets outside of the windows so that the workers could no longer jump out and take their lives. So these are products that we use every day. These are, you know, the phone in your pocket or in your purse, the computer that you use in the office. A lot of these electronic products are made under these grueling conditions. So I want to now just bring it back to the Trans-Pacific Free Trade Agreement. So one of the reasons that corporations are pushing for the Trans-Pacific Free Trade Agreement is because they're looking for low-cost labor, labor that's going to be cheaper even than China. Actually, they want to undercut these Chinese working conditions in places like Vietnam or other countries within the Pacific Rim. When people refer to the global race to the bottom, this is exactly what they're talking about. And you don't need an economics degree any more than you need to be a priest or a rabbi to realize that the damage and the wrong that this race to the bottom is causing for people in this country and abroad is obviously absolutely devastating. So Greg's going to talk to us a little bit more about trade-related job loss a little bit later, but let me just talk for a second about the implications of this trade deal on jobs in the economy. So the U.S. deficit has skyrocketed since because of the U.S. trade policy. Before NAFTA, we had a slight surplus with Mexico. Now we have a massive trade deficit. We had a pretty sizable deficit with China before China joined the WTO. Now it's gargantuan. In 2008, the U.S. trade deficit was $816 billion. If things continue on the current course, soon it's going to be over $1 trillion a year. When as a nation we're buying considerably more than we're selling, obviously this means net job loss for the country, and it's not complicated. The U.S. Department of Labor certified that 2.5 million American jobs were lost either to direct offshoring or displacement by imports since NAFTA passed. So that includes 50,000 jobs here in Oregon. That number doesn't include service sector jobs, which would include like call center jobs, computer programming, engineering, things like that. And those are also jobs that were offshored. So the true number of the job loss here in the U.S. Is easily double that figure. So that's the legacy of past trade deals. So what about the future? The Trans-Pacific FTA is currently being negotiated between 12 different countries. It's the U.S., Vietnam, Singapore, Malaysia, Brunei, Australia, New Zealand, Chile, and Peru. But there's also bilateral negotiations taking place so that Canada, Japan, and Mexico can also join. So as I've talked about a little bit earlier, just among those 12 countries, this is already way bigger than NAFTA. But the Trans-Pacific FTA is also significant because it's being negotiated as a docking agreement, which means that other countries can join on over time after it passes. So theoretically, any country in the Pacific Rim can join. Negotiations have been underway on this deal since 2010. But so far, none of the text has been officially released. In fact, the U.S. Forced countries to sign a document swearing that they would not release any of the negotiating documents until at least 5 years after, after the negotiations were over. In other words, journalists, our U.S. congressmen, you, me, and the people, you know, throughout this country and throughout the world whose livelihoods are going to be most impacted by this trade deal do not have access to the those negotiating documents. They don't know what is being negotiated for or what is being negotiated away until after it's complete. And, you know, at that point, it's virtually impossible for us to make changes. This sort of backroom dealing is completely outrageous. It doesn't benefit anyone but the people who are at the top who are able to have access to negotiators. While you and I are barred from reviewing these negotiating documents, approximately 600 corporate lobbyists are acting as official advisors, which means that they not only have access to the negotiating documents, but also the negotiators. So it's not unreasonable to assume that corporations are literally writing these texts. And at the very least, there is standing over the shoulder of negotiators and saying, you know, that doesn't really work for us. Why don't you scratch that and try this? What we know about the Trans-Pacific FTA and as far as the U.S. proposals we've gotten from conversations with negotiators, with lobbyists, and from a small handful of texts that have been leaked. What we know about the U.S. proposals for labor standards in the Trans-Pacific FTA is that they're essentially the same as what we got under George W. Bush. The Bush administration, much to the cheers of big corporation and the jeers of labor movements across the world, wrote a footnote, in the Korea Free Trade Agreement specifically barring the deal from being used to enforce International Labor Organization's conventions on the right to form a union, freedom from discrimination, freedom against forced labor, and so on. Reports suggest that the same language is repeated in the Trans-Pacific FTA. So this is very much celebrated by companies like Nike. Nike already produces 40% of their merchandise in Vietnam. Under the trade deal, they'll not only get to import into the U.S. and other countries in the Pacific Rim, they'll get to do it without paying taxes. So this makes it much easier for manufacturers to lower wages and conditions in China. And, you know, they may outright just shift their production to cheaper manufacturing countries like Vietnam. If this happens, it'll absolutely depress wages throughout the world, including here in Oregon. You can't produce the majority of the world's stuff in these vicious, ever-declining sweatshop conditions and not expect it to further weaken our already dwindling middle class. So if the Trans-Pacific FTA is enacted as currently envisioned, even more Oregonians will see their jobs shipped overseas. And even if you're a firefighter or a home care worker, this still impacts you because it puts pressure on wages, downward pressure on wages, and that's across all industries. It also creates competition from an ever-growing pool of unemployed workers whose jobs have been offshored. And of course, those manufacturing jobs, service jobs that we lose, result in less tax revenue. So there's less money for public services like firefighting, public health, education, libraries, you name it. So those are the economic impacts. Let me talk just for a second about some other aspects of the Trans-Pacific FTA. The little text that has been leaked has been around intellectual property rights. So when I talk about intellectual property rights, you might think of like Hollywood. And certainly there's parts of the Trans-Pacific FTA that anyone opposed to SOPA would go back to their closets and bring out their rally signs again. But one of the proposals that has been leaked and has been studied in depth on intellectual property has to do with pharmaceuticals. The drug companies want to use this trade deal to both actually and effectively lengthen the term of patents around the world. And that's what the U.S. is now pushing for. So what this means for people throughout the Pacific Rim is that they'll be paying brand name monopoly prices for additional years on drugs that if the FTA were not to pass, would already be generics. That means higher drug prices for people here in the US. But for people in Malaysia, in Vietnam, this is essentially a death sentence for the people who are struggling with HIV or tuberculosis or other life-threatening diseases that would be manageable with access to medication. Doctors Without Borders and the American Medical Association and many others that are concerned about public health and human rights throughout the world have been calling out the Obama administration on this, so far with very little luck. If it moves forward, it will completely wipe out the president's goals of getting people with AIDS throughout the world access to life-saving drug treatments. For a disease like AIDS, the price of name brand drugs can be something like 50 times what the generic would cost. To give one more example, I'm going to talk about oil companies for just a second. The U.S. is pushing for investment provisions that would allow oil companies, or really any other industry for that matter, to challenge virtually any law, regulation, or even court decision that negatively affects cross-border trade or even cross-border investments. That means that any environmental law, land use law, or consumer safety law that influences trade or investment can be challenged in an international tribunal that completely circumvents our local domestic judicial system. If the company wins, that country has to pay a big fine, and of course that's our tax dollars. If the country does not win, or the, I'm sorry, actually, if the country does not want another suit against them, then they have to, of course, change their policy. So under the WTO, the U.S. has already lost 90% of the 65 cases brought against it. This has resulted in weakening portions of the Clean Air Act, of the Endangered Species Act, and the Marine Mammal Protection Act. The difference between the WTO and the Trans-Pacific Free Trade Agreement is that the WTO allows countries to bring forth challenges. But the U.S. is has been pushing for the Trans-Pacific FTA to allow individual corporations to issue challenges. Canada is one of the only fully developed countries the U.S. has this type of agreement with under NAFTA, and we've already had to defend against numerous challenges. The Trans-Pacific FTA would extend that to nations throughout the Pacific Rim, and that includes export nations like Japan, which already have big investments here in the U.S. So this is something that would put our own laws at further risk and would especially threaten the democratic rights of small countries that are more vulnerable to attacks from corporations. I'm glossing over this a bit, but you can see how this will be a tool for corporations to put powers into their own hands at the expense of local sovereignty and community sovereignty. There's all sorts of other chapters in the Trans-Pacific FTA, but those are the examples, those are some examples of the way, of where it's heading now. And so what's dangerous about this is if we continue to let it be negotiated behind closed doors, we're definitely not going to have a good chance of stopping this. So if we are going to, you know, stop this in its tracks, you know, we need to bring it to the light of day. So this is, this is something that we need to start speaking to our elected officials about now. A lot of elected officials are going to tell you, this isn't going to be ready until 2012. Let's just wait and see how negotiations go and then make an opinion about it. But I can tell you that if we wait that long, it's going to be too late. This is a trade deal that, it's not going to hit the floor of Congress until they already know that it's going to pass. It's going to go through fast track and get an up or down vote by Congress. And, if we took that strategy of waiting to see how it goes once it hits the floor of Congress, that's absolutely the worst strategy that we could take. So if we're going to derail this thing, or less likely get a fair deal out of this thing, we need to engage now. And that has to happen before these negotiations are over. We can get started by, letting our elected officials, know that we want them to make certain demands. And if our elected officials are making demands of negotiators, whether that's on labor standards or financial regulations, environmental protections or drug patents or what have you, this is going to be a huge positive for us. It makes the negotiators' life difficult, and it makes it much more difficult for them to get this to the floor of Congress. They want to rush through a backroom deal and, negotiate all of this behind closed doors, and it's our job to make sure that that doesn't happen. The good news is that we're not alone. There's events like this happening all throughout the state. In fact, we are doing a total of 6 in our Trade Justice Roadshow. And then there's events happening all throughout the country and all throughout the Pacific Rim. People are learning and getting active, and that's happening particularly in a lot of other countries. Already in Japan, something like 10% of the country has signed a petition opposing this free trade agreement. And they've only been at this for a month, so that's really a huge thing. So, their negotiators are seriously not going to have an easy time with this, and it's our job to make sure our negotiators don't have an easy time either. The strategy of killing a bad trade deal by exposing it to the light of day, it's worked in the past. So it killed the millennial Doha rounds at the WTO. It killed the free trade area of the Americas. It also killed the multilateral agreement on investment. And it will work again. So I think the key is to making sure that people know about the Trans-Pacific FTA, know why it matters, and explain a little bit more about why it matters, I'm going to introduce our speakers.
Well, good evening. As she said, I'm Greg Pallesen. I'm the Vice President of the Association of Western Pulp and Paper Workers, and I'm actually out of Local 580 in Longview, Washington, but I'm the International Vice President and then the Political Director. And, you know, as always, I find it interesting on people and groups we talk to, with politicians that they think we're against trade. We want trade. We endorse trade. Trade is good, but it's got to be fair and equitable and impact people's lives, you know, in a positive way. I want to give you just a couple examples of mill closures and then explain a little bit about, the buzzword that a lot of us hear, which is job creators, right? And I'm going to give you an example of some job creators. But, as in the pulp and paper industry and forest product industry, logging and cutting trees is very controversial. But what I do know is when the occasion arises, I like using toilet paper. And I don't know any other substitute, and I want to be able to get toilet paper, just like I like to have writing paper. And we need products, and we have to have products. We want products made with pollution levels and environmental impact as low as possible. And the mills in the United States are some of the cleanest mills in the world. Our environmental logging practices are some of the best. And what's ended up happening with the offshoring of our jobs is, heavy environmental damage worldwide. I'll give you a couple examples in Oregon on mills. I don't know how many of you are familiar with what was called the Blue Heron paper mill in Oregon City. It's 100% recyclable or recovered waste paper they use, to make the product, right? Now, when you recycle paper, you can use the recycled paper, depending on the product you're making, 4 or 5 times. The fiber breaks down, and eventually you have to have, new material. But that was a mill that used 100% recovered waste paper. It's closed, and there's a lot of reasons why it closed, but one of the main reasons is because no matter what the mill would pay for recovered waste paper, the Chinese are outbidding them. Of all the paper products or paper materials that the U.S. exports, recovered waste paper is our highest export. It's hard to believe. And almost all of it is going to China. We have numbers. In fact, I've just got numbers here that came in about a week ago on, again, this year, U.S. exports of recovered waste paper to China rose about 23%, which means they're growing, right, a lot on their industry, and we're not. And so that was one of the main reasons why that mill closed. In the last, number of years, a little over 10, every location where we represent members that work in pulp and paper mills, and we represent members in Washington, Oregon, Idaho, Utah, and California, at every location, that is either downsized and or closed has been approved for Trade Act benefits. And the Blue Heron Mill, is no different. Those workers were approved for Trade Act benefits. Now, how do you get, approved for Trade Act benefits? Well, you have to directly show, and it goes, you file a to be reviewed and an application to the Department of Labor. They do an investigation to see if imports or, your equipment being moved to other country is the main reason, the number one reason why you lost your job. And for the association in the last 10 years, every one of ours has been approved. That's the main reason. And now in SP Newsprint, which is in Newburg, Oregon, if some of you are familiar with that location, that's considered a sister mill to the Blue Heron Mill. And they filed bankruptcy protection. And again, it's a 100% recovered waste paper mill. And you think of Portland, this is one of the greatest cities in the United States and probably in the world for recycle, right? I mean, they've done a fantastic job of it. And it seems so, it doesn't make common sense to think that us as citizens, of the state, you recycle your stuff, you think it would be going back into the region to create jobs, to spur the economy here, and it's actually being bundled up and shipped to China and made into products there. A lot of it is, whatever it is, but container board or cardboard, and it's shipping products back here, right? And if the material that's shipped there ends up being consumed and reused there, it's that much more fiber that we don't use here. It certainly doesn't make sense. And I want to talk just a couple minutes here about, you know, job creators. Like I say, I just want to, you know, those are a couple examples of mills under pressure. Right now, I want to mention, too, to give you an example of in other states, in Washington State, in Everett, Washington, we are right now dealing with the closure of the Kimberly-Clark paper mill. It's been around about 100 years. They make a lot of towel material, paper material products for Costco. 750 people, direct jobs that we're losing. Close to 600 have been laid off already, permanently gone, again, approved for Trade Act benefits. We have about 150 or so left. And already, so the mill's still running till April. They're slowly taking it down, right? Already, Kimberly-Clark has started to dismantle those machines, those multi-million dollar paper machines. I don't know how many of you ever seen, been inside a paper mill. Huge. Very capital intensive. They're dismantling those machines. One of them's headed to Brazil to go into a Kimberly-Clark mill there. And another one's headed to China. And that's another, you know, misconception somehow I think that people have is they think that as these mills close and the machines go down, that it's old equipment and it's not needed, right? These are state-of-the-art machines. And so you think about it. I was an electrician, instrument technician on a machine up in Longview, Washington. Weyerhaeuser closed one of the machines in 2001, and then they closed the other big paper machine in 2004. And both times they said, you know, their general statement is these are machines that cannot compete on the world market. As we all speak today, those two huge paper machines are over in China, a company called Shandong, producing the same product that was made here. I mean, so, you know, not only, I mean, it's, you know, it's this movement, it's job loss, but it's the movement truly of our manufacturing equipment itself. Now I want to give you a quick example on legislation and the stuff you talk about in the trade agreements and the laws and things that are written, and then, you know, how our politics work with it. In 2005, Congress, and I don't know how many of you are familiar with what's called the black liquor tax. And what it is in pulp and paper mills, they have a boiler and they're burning, you know, the waste from when you cook chips, and they make power out of it, you know, electricity, steam and things, right? It's been going on for 100 years. In 2005, there was legislation that passed that granted a 50 cents per gallon tax credit for adding biofuels to fossil fuels used for, you know, transportation, right? Well, in 2007, an extension of that law included fuels for the purpose created, it was a loophole, right? Tax, unintended loophole for the pulp and paper industry. So instead of cutting fossil fuels with biofuel as the legislation intended, you know, they found a way around this, and they started to add diesel fuel, which is a much dirtier fuel, to the black liquor. But it gave them this 50 cents per gallon credit, tax credit, so to speak, right? And the Obama administration, for those of you that maybe have followed it, they wanted to do away with that tax credit to help pay for the national health care. In 2009, International Paper received about $2.06 billion as a result of this tax hole. In 2010, they received a little over $1 billion, right? So the tax hole ended up being, the tax loophole ended up being closed. But after that, the pulp and paper industry dispatched their accountants and their IRS people and, you know, went over to the, you know, to the IRS. And now there's what's called the son of black liquor. And because of, you know, it was tried to correct this tax loophole, but now they get $1.01 per gallon. So it almost doubled. And Georgia-Pacific, which is owned by the Koch brothers, are one of the largest recipients of this tax break. These companies are getting billions of dollars in tax credits handed to them, our money, right? And then they claim, excuse me, that they're job creators. Now, with International Paper, as I said, in 2 years' time with them, they got $3 billion in tax credits. During that exact same time, now you got to keep in mind, they told Congress that they needed this to keep the industry afloat in the United States, right? During this exact same time of getting $3 billion, they did a $4 billion investment in Indonesia, a $2 billion investment in Russia. Last summer, they bought 15 mills in China, and they bought controlling interests of a paper conglomerate in India. And at the same time, they closed the Albany paper mill, which was profitable. And we know that because we represented the workers there, and they were in profit sharing. And at the same time, they closed a big paper mill in Franklin, Virginia. the day after they closed those two mills, and these mills made what's called container board, right, cardboard material. The day after, International Paper raised the price that they were selling container board for 15% on the East Coast and 18% on the West Coast. I mean, it's all, you know, kind of a scam job, so to speak. And the impact, obviously, on workers here is permanent job loss. These mills will never be replaced back in the United States. And, you know, so they talk about job creators. Yeah, GP's been a great job creator overseas with our tax dollars. Not only are they taking their profits and investing, but they invested over $3 billion of our, and you know, I don't know about all you, but if you track the pulp and paper industry, I don't know the last time I've ever seen an investment of, you know, a couple billion dollars in the industry here. It, you know, it ought to be criminal what they're doing with regard to that, right? I mean, it's just a shame, but that's happening throughout the United States in the pulp and paper industry. We've lost tremendous amount of jobs, and when you think about it, you know, as like I said, as controversial as logging and all that is, we still want the product. We want it made as safe as possible, clean as possible, and the least impact on the environment. And the United States is, you know, the best on that. I find it quite ironic with how, you know, we have state legislative people that want to pass good environmental laws and good labor laws and all these things that we all want, right, to be treated fairly. And then those same politicians turn around and they'll vote yes for a trade agreement that doesn't have anything in that, any of that, and shame on them. And I'll just, you know, end with this. You know, when I've talked with people, and I'm sure a number of you have discussed this, but, you know, you hear about the trade deficit, right, the national deficit. But you don't hear the politicians talking much about the trade deficit. Well, why not? Because, really, that's the cause of our national deficit in many ways, right? They don't talk about it because they voted yes on it, the majority of them. And they continue to vote yes. And, you know, so on the federal side, when I've talked with people, I've said, you know, forget for a bit about how broke the federal government is and how big the federal government is. Let's look at the states and look at the counties and look at the cities. Virtually every state in the nation is broke. The counties are broke, right? Cities are broke. Have on the state government, in all the states in the United States, has the state government grown so huge they've consumed all of our tax dollars? Simple question, and to me it's a simple answer. No. So why are they broke? Well, they're broke because we've lost our tax base. Why have we lost our tax breaks? Two main reasons. One is tax breaks to the very rich, the job creators you heard me talk about that are creating elsewhere, right? But because we as working class people have either lost our jobs, which that tax base is gone, or we've taken huge pay cuts, and which has impacted that, right? And why have we lost our jobs? It's because of trade acts and the unfair movement of jobs. The Trade Act benefits I spoke about started in about 1976. In the first 10 years in Oregon, there were 40 locations approved for Trade Act benefits. In the last 10 years in Oregon, there have been over 400 approved for Trade Act benefits. If anybody cares to have a list and take a look at it, I can let you know where the website is. There's 13 pages here of small print, and every one of these are certified. Now, there's a number of places that, you know, this impacts in the stream is just terrible, you know, with what's going on the jobs and with working class people. And then with all of that, you know, you'll hear the politicians say, well, we'll retrain you and you'll go get a better job or a good job. We don't know of anyone that's gone off, and we've asked the politicians and we've asked people, tell me who's gone off to do better. Who's gone to get a better job with better benefits than what's there? And they don't have it. And then with all of that, on every negotiation, labor negotiation that we're doing, you know, you hate to say it, but the reality is every one of those negotiations is concessionary. So even if a place is profitable and making money, those employers are so aggressive and so vicious that they're still cutting wages and benefits, and it's just a shame what's happening.
Well, on that cheery note, thank you, Greg, and thank you for your work, and a lot of what I have to say is pretty pale by comparison, but I hope it will be helpful as we think about some of the challenges that we have going forward. I'm Ted Gleichman, as Elizabeth noted, and I'm going to quickly hit three things that we all know, then two key things that we all need to know, point out two conclusions for Pacific Trade that come out of those, and those, I think, relate to the challenges that Elizabeth educated us about this evening. Thank you for that. And then two quick final points. First, We all know that imports without top quality labor and environmental standards are a scam and a sham. Second, we all know that exports are not automatically good, not necessarily an economic plus, especially as we become more and more a resource colony for Asia. One example, industrial timber companies have gutted Oregon's lumberjack, sawmill, lumber, and paper production jobs by clear-cutting and exporting raw logs. And Greg gave us a lot more salient and substantive detail about exactly how brutal and how greedy that's been. Third, we all know that the WTO is an imposition on human rights, a conspiracy by the 1%. It's causing the destruction of basic sovereignty, and it needs to be stopped. Now, that's a topic for another day, but it's important because it's a key piece of the long-term solution. For simplicity, I'm calling these three issues the trade rapes, because there's a new one on the way. Now, here are the two key things we need to know. First, climate disruption is real. It's already happening big time. It's being caused primarily by industrial society based on fossil fuels, and it's probably going to get much worse, much more quickly than we expect. Second, we can solve the jobs crisis with clean, green, good jobs, union jobs, and adapt to climate disruption at the same time, with a full court press on renewable energy, building reconstruction, infrastructure reconstruction and development, and agriculture and forest rehabilitation and development. All of these technologies and concepts are ready for prime time. These are not pie in the sky. These are available. This leads us to two conclusions on Pacific trade. First, we're facing a major push to export fossil fuels from the Pacific Northwest, and this will make everything worse on all of these problems. The use of American coal and natural gas for manufacturing in Asia will just give them cheap energy to continue to undercut jobs here, in no small part because their environmental standards are so much lower. While the emissions from this manufacturing based on these exported cheap fossil fuels will speed up the climate disruption throughout the globe. Exporting fossil fuels is the fourth trade rape. Second, the huge fights just beginning over those export plans offer labor a whole new set of allies on the trade rapes. Two in particular stand out to me. Urban, suburban, white-collar employees, and college students. There are millions of people working in non-union jobs who are becoming increasingly concerned about climate disruption, and they are overwhelmingly positive toward renewables and sustainable solutions. And college students are reading the facts, not watching Fox News. They understand the science, and they are deeply worried. We can build alliances across normal boundaries if we take advantage of these changes in the demographics and the economy that we're facing. Finally, there are a couple things that I hope can help us. A Saudi oil minister said many years ago, "The Stone Age did not end because we ran out of stone. We came up with something better. We started to tap into ancient sunlight, ancient energy stores, fossil fuels, and it provided us with the beauties and the strengths and the pleasures of industrial society. We all use fossil fuels every day. But we have reached a point now, we have moved into a series of tipping points, many of which may be irrevocable, where fossil fuels have flipped from a plus to a minus. And there's nothing written in stone that says that we have to burn every last drop of hydrocarbon on the planet. Now that we have better, clean, green technologies that can provide us with clean, green, good jobs. The fossil fuel industry will tell us just the opposite. Let's stick with what we know. But the best way to understand what's currently going on is to look at extreme weather and to look at the ice. Think about Joplin, Missouri. I was on the East Coast right after and during the long, long aftermath of Hurricane Irene. Think about the drought in Texas and Oklahoma and northern Mexico, where there are now 2 million people, 2 million people in northern Mexico without water, as we sit here tonight, as I speak, assembling out of the hills at points across the region where the government is trucking in water. So if they come north looking for survival, should we send water trucks or should we beef up the border? What kind of choice do you think the politicians who are passing these trade agreements will make? Our current experiences with extreme weather are just the tip of the iceberg, another bad pun. And the ice itself is beginning to tell the tale. Sea level has risen by 8 inches since 1950, since we started having really good information to track it. And that rate of increase has doubled in the last 12 to 15 years. And that rate of increase is accelerating as we speak. There's a group in Colorado called Extreme Ice Survey, University of Colorado, and they do wonderful photography of the kinds of things that are actually happening. Ice is not a computer model. Ice is not a group of climatologists trying to figure out one of the most complicated sets of systems that people have ever examined. Ice can be measured directly and it can be looked at. I'm going to pass this around, but there are two pictures that I think you can sort of see from a distance here. We've all seen pictures of glaciers vanishing, starting to expose ground that has not been exposed for millennia. You may be familiar with Otzi, as he was named, the 14,000-year-old murder victim who was found in the Italian Alps as one of the glaciers retreated there. Was killed by an arrow to the back, as it turns out. But glaciers don't just retreat, they also thin out. I think you can see the Empire State Building showing how this particular glacier has dropped down, not just pulled back, but also dropped down in terms of size. So if you happen to have a place on the coast, you should be aware that there are two institutions that are at the cutting edge of the analysis of climate disruption and climate change. One is the insurance industry, and the other is the military-industrial complex, the CIA and the Pentagon. They're deep into how to cope, and we'll be seeing, over the next few years, we'll be seeing increasing insurance rates. It's already happened in Florida. The Republican legislature in Florida, because of the hurricanes and the beginnings, the impending beginnings of coastal erosion from sea level increase, has really been, insurance has been abandoned in Florida. And the Republican legislature has created a state-owned insurance company as the insurer of last resort. With Floridians' tax dollars, because they had no option. People couldn't sell houses because they couldn't get homeowners insurance. But one Katrina-type hurricane will completely wipe out that entire new state corporation which is the same size as the entire state budget. So this stuff is brutal, and it's going to get worse. I was telling Kim that I typically introduce myself to people now by saying, I'm obviously a member of the generation destroying the earth for your generation. Sorry about that. Hope you do better. Some of us still want to make a difference. That conversation usually then finishes up with, and could I please have the house coffee with extra room? Because that's the jobs that are available for your generation. So we have a lot of work to do, and we've been led well so far by the people who are inspiring us to do it. Thank you.
My name's Kim. I come out of, I've been organizing in Oregon since 1994, direct action organizing, mostly Earth First. And most recently, Rising Tide North America. I spent a lot of time now and for the last number of years doing a lot of work around strategic campaigning and alliance building, how to build alliances, how to make your campaign more effective. You know, when you start looking at your campaign plans and the types of targets or the entities you want to go after, whether it's a trade agreement or a corporation, you always start off by asking, you want to start off by asking yourself, you know, what's your vision for the world? Who's hindering you from reaching that vision? That's going to give you some corporations, some targets, or some trade bills, maybe. And then you want to ask yourself, who else is impacted? Who else is impacted by that entity or that target? And that list is your potential list of allies for you to move forward with and figure out how to work with each other. Now, labor has been ahead of us in the environmental movement on really looking at corporations and doing research to break down who are our best targets and how do we build allies around this. And in 1998, when I was looking at new tree sets to put up, we got a call from the Steelworkers Union, who had done just that sort of research. And they said, hey, we did our research, and we figured out that Kaiser Aluminum is owned by the same person who owns Maxam Lumber, who's cutting down your redwoods that you care about. Do you think we could work together? I was like, I don't see why not. You know, so we sat down, we had a meeting, we talked about it, we came up with a campaign strategy on how do we work together to take down this corporation, or how to get the workers back their jobs. And that started a huge coalition of work. That wasn't easy. And the first thing we decided to do was, let's take a risk. Let's see. Corporations and politicians say it's supposed to be jobs or the environment, and we're not supposed to play nice with each other or get along. And what we realized is that's the first myth that we need to destroy if we're going to be effective activists. Because we can have a healthy economy, and we can have healthy ecosystems. And so we sat down with the steelworkers of Tacoma, and we decided to stop an ore ship from coming in. We had a first meeting. What's Earth First's skill set? We're really good at stopping things. Really good at it. What's labor's skill set? Really good at turning out numbers. Really good at looking, like, there's a lot of strength with labor unions. They impose strength in the media, to politicians, and encourage their members to come out for events. So we teamed up, and we shut down the port of Tacoma. We got up there, we hung off the banner cranes, shut it down. And after that, we had a hot dog and tofu dog roast in celebration to realize that we could, in fact, work together. And what do we want to do next? We had a lot of fun that day. Because when you're looking at picket lines, the weakness that labor unions have is they have a lot of rules they need to follow on a picket line. Earth First, not so much with the rules. So we were able to find a lot of flexibility and ways to help each other out. And we had a lot of opposition. Government, corporations, right-wing radio shows panicked when they saw that we were working together and building alliances. And they came after us, but they weren't successful. Following those actions, we decided to, let's figure this out. Let's sit down with as many environmentalists that you know and as many labor folks as they know and figure out what can we really do together. We have the WTO trade agreements coming up. There are other larger issues. So we got into a room no bigger than this with about 35, 40 activists in Arcata, closer to where the redwoods were. We did huge protests during the day where we had steel workers out there running around in the woods with us trying to save the trees, and they were like, why are you guys afraid of these loggers? They're small. We're like, no, not compared to us. But we had a whole day. We spent so much time working together that when we sat down, we started doing our first roadshow. I was, you know, prepared to give a presentation while the environment, why forests are important to protect, assuming that the steelworker I was on the roadshow with was going to talk about you know, what was going on with their strike and how the corporation was messing with the workers. And he went first. He was a large guy from Ohio. His first time being in the Redwoods was earlier that day, and he gave a whole presentation on forest protection. I was like, oh, I guess I'm talking about the strike and the history of labor unions. And it was amazing. So anyways, back to that room where we got together and we tried to figure out how we can work together. And we did a brainstorm. You popcorn out all the ideas that you could possibly work on together. We talked about everything from dam removal to making Kaiser Aluminum a co-op, so a worker-owned co-op. We had three sheets of paper filled up, and the end of it, the steelworkers were like, there's no way we can work with you guys. We cannot work on these issues. And so we came up with a strategy. Let's put three sheets of paper on one piece of paper, everything that we can work on with each other right now, with how well we know each other. Things that maybe as we establish trust and get to know each other, we'll be able to tackle. And then things that are trigger conversations for us, we're going to put that on a separate sheet of paper and fold it up, and we're not going to have a conversation about that stuff for now. And with that, we were able to move forward on some very healthy working relationships. We started the Alliance for Sustainable Jobs and the Environment, where we worked to stop the FTAA. We set up groups on restoration to stop the timber sale program and work on developing restoration programs in our forest, and many others. We were half labor, half environmentalist, working together on those issues pretty equally. We started, a lot of groups started out of that, like the Blue-Green Alliance. The most important lesson during that time period was really learning how to work with people. One mistake I feel like we make is we keep looking to people who look like us, who maybe dress like us, and we only talk to each other. You see canvassers doing it all the time. Where are they canvassing? Greenpeace canvassers are outside the health food stores. Why aren't they outside Safeway? You have to take some risks, and you have to shelf your judgments and what you think the other people are going to think of you in order to try to work with each other. And you don't have to lose your morals. You don't have to shelf what your primary vision or values are to find that common ground. But the most important piece of it is at the beginning. When you don't want to start a coalition because you think it's a good idea to have someone from a union at your protest, because that's using somebody. That's not building a coalition. A coalition makes sense as, hey, we want to stop this trade agreement. Who's affected by it? Well, a lot of these environmental groups are affected by it, and hey, these unions are going to lose jobs over this. Let's get together and see what the common ground is ahead of time. Not, oh my gosh, it's 2 days before the protest. We should have an environmentalist there. We need to look to long-term strategies if we're going to build these relationships and take down these large entities, because these trade agreements, they did not come out of thin air. These corporations have been scheming and planning for decades in small rooms together. And if we don't stop and take a step back and start building some coalitions and meeting them on a level with strategy and planning, we're always going to be scrambling to catch up with them. We're never going to be able to say, hey, this is the vision of the world we want. We're always going to be stop this, no, stop that, and never get to the place where we get to ask ourselves what we want. I'm just going to share a personal story. Coming out of working with labor, we stopped a huge timber sale in Washington State. You know, up until then, we had kind of had loggers versus environmentalists or mill workers against environmentalists that were going on pretty heavily. We made a lot of assumptions on both sides. Watch Mountain was a 4,000-acre land exchange that was happening. We decided to go into the town of Randall and start meeting with people and talking to them about what was going on with them, with their town. We learned that the mill in their area had closed. Another one had bought it out and then shut it down. They were going to buy it out to restore it, but then they just bought out and shut it down to keep the competition away. The company that bought it was going to export everything overseas, and their idea of hiring locally was from over 100 miles away. So we're like, let's go talk to the town people and see what's going on. Let's see if we can work together or not. We went in there, and we found a couple of allies in there who taught us how to work inside that town, what to do. The first thing they said is we pretty much have to move there if we want to work there. This is Randall, Washington. I think there was 2,000 addresses in the town. Very small town. And we put together a huge town hall meeting. And we invited the timber company, Plum Creek, to come and talk. We also invited local loggers and foresters and environmentalists to talk. We put up a tree sit. And we wound up building a huge campaign in that town that was led by the town to stop that timber sale. We had loggers in our tree sit. We had the head of the local mill, a part of our coalition, helping us stop that timber sale, and we won. We won because it wasn't just us fighting against the politicians. It was the loggers from that community coming with us to lobby the Sierra Club, to lobby the governments who were trying to clear cut that area, and we were able to save it because we worked together. So there's just a lot of power to taking risks and figuring out how we can work with each other. I don't know how many people here have worked in coalitions. Okay. And how many people have went home from a coalition meeting being like, why did I do that? They're not easy. They're not easy. It takes a lot of work. But how many people have won campaigns because of it, or have saved something because of it, right? It was so nice for me when I went into, I don't lobby, I'm not a lobbyist. My background's in direct action, but I went into lobby with the steelworkers, and because one of the steelworkers went first about the importance of saving forests, they thought he was the environmentalist. They thought we were both environmentalists, and so he said, oh, it's not really, I want to side with you, but it's actually the steelworkers who are doing this. And he was like, I am the president of my union. Actually, I'm sorry if you misunderstood that. And they weren't able to play us off each other throughout the durations of our campaigns, and it was really nice. Way of forcing politicians to be quasi-honest. I don't know what else I want to share with you tonight. I just wanted to leave you with a little bit of anecdotes and thoughts about the importance of working with people who are not just like you, working in groups that have diversity of age, financial backgrounds, different passions. Because the reality is that we're going to be, the more diverse our groups are, the stronger we're going to be, and the easier it's going to be for us to take down our targets. You have a group like PCAS who have thought through it and are looking at corporations where a lot of people have issues with them, and there's a way for a bunch of groups to get their agenda, into the mix and into the messaging. So when they go forward against the corporations, they can't pit us against each other or just be like the waterbed effect. We're like, okay, well, if we save this one little area, that we can do all this horrible stuff over here. And we really need to just take a deep breath and build some coalitions so we can tackle these common enemies together. Because really, capitalism stands on two legs. It really needs to have control of the land and cheap labor in order for it to keep running at the rate that it's been running. And the only way for us to stop it having access to both is by joining together and fighting them head on.